what's called the farm gate model. And what it looks at is, and this slide I didn't want to change, but we'll run with it here. The assessment tool, just click through this. What that was meant to show is the curriculum is often bigger, or should be bigger, than the single assessment tool which we created. So the curriculum is everything that's nice to know and the need to know. Those crosses throughout that point are some assessment points. They're not necessarily a summative assessment, but they're assessment points that are important as we go through the course, and they lead to a single assessment tool which we created. In doing that, we also utilised some of those crosses that are just naturally occurring evidence and documentation that is already existing within the farm environment, like shed plans and tanker dockets, which all form part of the naturally occurring evidence for assessment. We also looked at the training impact. This is some work by Professor Robert Brinkerhoff in the high impact learning model. Quite often we look at the training impact as the training intervention or the learning intervention, which is the actual course itself. What we found though, that actually greater than 40% of training fails when people aren't prepared. Some of the reasons for that: wrong people attended, no clear reason for attending the course, didn't need it. Only 15% of impact is lost at the actual learning intervention. That's they could not learn it, wanted to learn it, but the instruction failed. Bad training design and materials and the facilitator did a bad job. And again, it's higher at the other end, greater than 40% of learning is lost if they don't get to apply it. So they didn't get any management support, had no opportunity to try it, lack of peer support, no incentive to use it, or lack of feedback and coaching. Professor Brinkerhoff's work also shows that if they don't go back on and apply the learning within 10 days, a lot of the learning is lost, and within 21 days, the learning is virtually zero. So our focus was on quality tutors, quality training tools. We ensured there was pre-course focus and pre-course work. We had expert assessors that had the industry knowledge and also the assessor skills, especially in the world of professional conversation. We ensured the on-farm application can do part of the course. And it was tied in with the key business outcome of quality milk. The resources we created were clear, concise, simple. Our assessment document for the whole qualification is just this one sheet that our expert assessors use. These are just some shots of our pre-course and trainees manuals, and I've got copies of all this stuff here for if you want to have a look. These are the six national standards. Don't need to read them all there, but that's just to give you a graphical example. There is six unit standards sitting on the framework, and to ensure that we actually meet those unit standards, we develop up a matrix, which links straight back to our one-page assessment sheet. The unit standards and the matrix are in the background. Our assessors, our trainers don't even get to see any of that stuff. They're merely there to be put on the framework. And the tools, the training resources, and the assessment sheet are what is used out in front. The results. So far, 6,896 people have enrolled in our Licensed to Milk program. 4,861 national certificates have been issued, so that's people that have been competent, which represents, I would say that's a conservative estimate of 35,000 learning hours. Some other achievements that we actually did find by this course is we actually got changed behaviours out on farm, which is just a huge important area as well. People were feeling empowered. As I said before, they often had bad times at school, so this is the first qualification that they may actually achieve. People were sending whole farm teams along to our courses so that they were approaching it with peers, which gave them support, and there was interesting industry employment retention, so a lot more people are staying in the actual industry, which our industry funders are and more than happy with. Also, we've felt that we've passed the assessment back into the hands of the learners. Often the assessor will not come out onto the farm and do the final assessment until the learner feels that they're ready. So we've actually passed the whole assessment is driven from the learner. We've got a 50% improvement in the number of suppliers that exceed 10 demerit days per season. So when there's 14 billion litres of milk being collected and 25% of that could be contaminated, the numbers are huge of what we've actually saved the company, the country and businesses. We've moved on, we've got a stage 2 program for managers, stage 3 for mastitis management. We've actually also developed an effluent management program, and we're also looking at technology now and offering that as another form of assessment for people to use. Again, as Professor Ball said this morning, learners are different, and so they may appreciate different ways to be assessed. That's me really. I've got examples of everything up the front here, and also a bit of a case study that we did from some actual users' point of views, which you can obviously get at the end. Thank you.
Through standards and its maintenance, through contributions, challenges, the way forward, and then conclude. The aims of education of every nation should reflect the needs and values of that society or that country. And these, to get sound education, we must drive on quality of facilities. And when we say facilities, I mean infrastructure. We're talking about amenities, and we're talking about logistics. Then we're talking about quality of teaching, and then also the quality of method of assessment. Now, the broad aims of education in Ghana, because this topic is with particular reference to Ghana, the broad aims of education in Ghana include the training of well-balanced individuals to have requisite knowledge, skills, values, aptitudes, and attitudes to become functional and productive for total national development. How do we achieve these goals? There's a need to set and maintain standards in education. Now, what's a standard? After looking around, I thought that the best definition I could get was from the Carter Dictionary, which says, the level of quality of excellence that is accepted as a norm by which actual attainments are judged, and this suits me perfectly. Now, why is it important to have standards? Every nation has assessment standards, and to help shape the quality of education, there's a need to maintain them. And at this point, every nation or every society or every community has its own standards. Different communities or different nations have their own standards, and depending on what they have and what their needs and values are. And these are, that is, to maintain them, to constantly improve quality in education delivery, to accurately predict performance of candidates in concert with other factors, and also to ensure reliability and validity in the ultimate system of assessment. Now, to maintain these standards, there's a need to identify the needs and aspirations of the resources and the challenges of that community we're dealing with, to set the goals and targets, provide quality infrastructure in schools, to train and motivate teachers, effectively supervise teaching and learning in schools. If you train and motivate teachers without supervising their work, you'll be running at a loss. And then finally, to ensure reliable, valid system of assessment, and that's the thrust of this paper. Maintaining standards in assessment here can be done by reliable and fair systems of assessment. This function, as far as West Africa goes, was entrusted to the West African Exams Council in 1952 by statute to discharge in its member countries. Now, what's the West African Examinations Council? It's the foremost and largest examining body in West Africa and has the mandate to, one, determine the examinations required in the public interest, to conduct those examinations and award certificates that are comparable to reputable organizations internationally. The membership of WAEC is made up of 5 countries in Anglophone West Africa. They are Nigeria, Ghana, and that's where the headquarters is situated, Sierra Leone, the Gambia, and Liberia. Now, WAEC as a partner, who does WAEC partner with? Achieving and maintaining the educational standards is a holistic affair that involves a whole lot, a gamut of stakeholders. One organization can't do it alone. And therefore, WAEC, in this case, partners first with governments of its member countries to implement policies on education as appropriate. It also partners with education authorities, teachers, parents, and students in the cases of assessing candidates based on the teaching syllabuses. And then also it partners with other examining authorities. Now, WAEC conducts 4 categories of examinations. We have the national examination, and an example of that is the Basic Education Certificates exams, BECE, at the pre-secondary level. And then the international examination, an example is the West African Senior School Certificate Examination, which is at the pre-tertiary level. And then the third one is in collaboration with other organizations. And then on the fourth one is on behalf of other examining bodies such as ETS, where we conduct TOEFL, GRE, and GMAT. WAEC uses established structures, and these have been tested over the years, and they elaborate to achieve its aims and objectives. And among these structures are the Test Development Division, TDD, which is everything, does everything from recruitment of examiners to the compilation of chief examiner's reports. And that's where the standard fixing and awards systems meetings take place. The Test Administration Division has everything to do with test administration. They do the marking exercises, that's conference marking, and finally release results and award certificates. And then the Computer Services Division, WAEC is very aware of the power of technology and therefore continues to deploy technology in all its processes as far as it can go to make work easier and to improve quality. And then the Research Division is by way of quality assurance, where processes are from time to time evaluated or investigated, all with the aim of improving the quality of education and maintaining standards. Now, WAEC's mission. WAEC seeks to develop and maintain internationally acceptable procedures and examinations. Second, to provide qualitative and reliable educational assessment. Third, to encourage academic and moral excellence among the youth. Fourth, to promote sustainable human resource development, mutual understanding, and international cooperation. Now, how does WAEC use these to maintain standards in educational assessment? Because it's so concerned with us, it encourages the conduct of validity tests. And an example is in 1993, the University of Cambridge Local Exam Syndicate was contracted to conduct a test to evaluate the entire examination of the first SSCE, that is the second the senior secondary school certificate examinations in Ghana for the first time. Over there, the results show that they found the processes were very good quality, the outputs very high, but there were some flaws that were identified, and WAEC took immediate steps to remedy these. Again, in 2002, the Accra Research Department also conducted a validity test, and this time it was to assess the content validity of 5 subjects, also at the SSSCE level. There again, there were strengths and weaknesses, and of course, WAEC took steps to correct the weaknesses to make it better for the future. After that, there have been so many others to date. WAEC also recruits competent personnel, and personnel in terms of both staff and functionaries, that's people who work for WAEC, after scrutiny procedures have taken place. It also engages mainly teachers and educationists as functionaries. And this is because WAEC believes that they are at the implementation level, and they teach the students or the candidates with a teaching syllabus. Okay, and it's out of the teaching syllabus the WAEC gets the examination syllabus. So if they are able to teach the students at that level well and have a working experience with WAEC, it's believed that they can translate whatever experiences they get into the classrooms and make the classroom teaching better and improve quality in education. Besides, periodically WAEC organizes training sessions for its staff and functionaries so that they don't grow rusty, to keep them on their toes. WAEC also holds briefing sessions for invigilators and supervisors, disseminates information through seminars and sensitization workshops. It also regularly supplies qualified human resource for national development. And here, that WAEC brings together candidates from 5 sovereign countries at the same time to write an examination and releases results, award certificates, such that these products are able to move ahead and help in their various national developments. That's what WAEC does to maintain standards and to improve quality as well. Again, WAEC also awards internationally acceptable certificates which go beyond the shores of West Africa, and they are recognized and help their products go further as far as development of their potentials that lie beyond education is concerned, or that lie beyond examinations is concerned. WAEC also gives international publicity to award winners when every year there are distinction and excellence awards for national and international award winners. And those who are privileged to win these awards are given publicity, international publicity, among other things. And I believe that with that kind of publicity, other schools and their education authorities will find it challenging so that they can live up to that and enjoy this kind of facility also, one time or another in their lives. So by this way, it helps improve quality and also maintain standards. WAEC also disseminates, if we've done this, okay. Now, what does WAEC have for the future? The vision of WAEC itself is to become a world-class examining body, adding value to the goals of its numerous stakeholders. And this alone positions WAEC for the future. And it realizes that there's a need to keep abreast with current trends and developments. How does it do this? By incorporating ICT and other forms of modern technology into procedures as far as it can go. by investing in capacity building and human resource development, as I mentioned earlier, by training its functionaries and staff as often as possible, even within the confines of available resources. WAEC also fraternizes with other international educational associations and examination bodies, such as the IAEA, the AEAA, the ACEAB, and others. All these it does so that it can bring itself up to modern standards and also improve on quality as much as share experiences with others and cross-fertilize ideas. WAEC also scrutinizes its activities through the work of research, and that's what the research department does mainly. And it also provides feedback to teachers and students through the release of results and the chief examiner's reports. Now, as we all know, in every endeavor, there are challenges. And so what are some of these challenges that WAEC faces in the discharge of their duties as far as maintenance of educational standards are concerned? As we heard this morning, the teaching syllabus or the examination syllabus is usually culled from the teaching syllabus, and that alone makes it very narrow in operation. And then WAEC examinations seems to be over concentrated on cognitive-based assessments at the expense of those from the other domains like the affective and the conactive, as we learned this morning, domains. Then there's a menace, and that's the biggest problem, the biggest headache that WAEC has of examination malpractice. It's a clear and present danger. The perpetrators of this crime continue to advance and to expand in dimension, in mode, and even in finesse. Then there's also the lack of internet access in many parts of the country to facilitate the ICT drive by WAEC, and that makes work a bit difficult. And then, to crown it all, difficulty in attracting and retaining qualified ICT professionals is a problem, because they are also always bidding for higher paid jobs, and WAEC has limits. So what's the way forward then? In the first place, if you're talking about internet facilities in all rural areas and other parts of the country, WAEC alone cannot do it. In fact, WAEC cannot do it at all. So it employs the help of governments. So we ask the governments to extend sustainable power and internet facilities to rural areas of the country, all rural areas, so that everybody, teachers, students, pupils, even parents, and everybody in education could have access to internet, the internet, and in fact the use of ICT. So that if children by age 6, for example, can use, deploy ICT very effectively, you can imagine what kind of future we'll have in our country. Then, I propose that WAEC should use the expertise of the board, of its board members, to influence the development of syllabuses to broaden national needs based on which WAEC can effectively assess candidates. Professor Boyle spoke about that this morning, so I won't elaborate. WAEC also should expand and intensify sensitization programs on its major operations so that stakeholders can understand and appreciate what goes into these operations, so that those who go out to buy question papers and things like that could now stop and have, you know, a better idea of what actually happens behind the scenes. WAEC, again, should encourage schools to access the chief examiner's reports to adequately acquaint themselves. It's through the chief examiner's reports that weaknesses and strengths of candidates on every subject area are displayed. So when they get this, they are able to know where their strengths are, where to build up, and then where to continue. And that makes it better and improves quality in the long run. Then also, WAEC should computerize the process, all its processes, to cover all the operations to computerize the processes to cover all its operations within the shortest possible time. Up to this point, WAEC has done quite a lot. There's an e-hosting of results, there's e-registration of candidates, there's e-capturing of marks after marking has taken place. There's even the payment of examiners through online, But there are so many other sections or other parts that WAEC should try to get into. For example, well, we'll get to that. For example, getting the having our tests, having the IBT, that is an internet-based test, for example, could help a great deal. And then we're asking the WAEC should develop a corporate website with a front desk, to attend to all problems that come up and need attention. And with that, we can also coordinate more effectively the technological aspects of our life, of our work, and then coordinate from all the 5 member countries and even beyond on one table. And from this website, for example, stakeholders could upload or download syllabuses and all those other things very easily. Of course, these things will have to be done only when the problems of internet plagiarism have been taken care of and all that. Then we're asking the WAEC also improves incentive package, an incentive package to attract and retain ICT professionals to help the ICT education go forward more fast. Then also to introduce innovative means to curb examination malpractices. What are these? Some of these innovative means are, for example, having a peer invigilation, where the students themselves, the candidates themselves, are made invigilators and they can check on one another when there's cheating in the exam hall. We could have parallel tests, such that the test materials of the same test, of course, the same paper, are mixed up row after row so that it doesn't really pay to giraffe or look onto your friend's paper for help. It will not help anybody. It will not help the candidates. When they get to know, these things can bring down their malpractices to a large extent. We're also asking that WAEC expand and resource their branch offices to absorb more responsibilities at the local and regional level. And this will help to decentralize the work and make it spread such that it can take on more responsibilities for the teaming stakeholders and candidates year after year. Then there should be more emphasis on practical oriented assessments, because earlier on in the challenges we mentioned that the tests are too cognitive based. Now we're asking that it should be practical oriented, especially for the sciences, agriculture, technical and vocational candidates. And then when we're able to do this, we can even extend the excellence awards to practical work to encourage such students to also aspire to the heights. We could also consider video conferencing or teleconferencing for all oral examinations, and this could cut down the costs of traveling and the risks involved. In the beginning, it may be capital intensive, but nothing good comes easy. In the long run, it will be cheaper for